Chameleons, lizards, and tadpoles. It hardly enters your mind that there's something better than this. I let us sleep in a carrot, maybe a scene from the parrot. Believe me when I tell you the word gourmet just don't exist. But these are power, I'm flying saucer food delight. Delight. These are power, oh, that's what makes us feel alright.
Hey guys. So why are we modding a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles machine? Well, I remember playing this game in the arcade as a kid, and it was awesome. I pumped a lot of quarters into it, and basically when you buy the game, it comes with Ninja Turtles, the arcade game, and Ninja Turtles 2, Turtles in Time, which I had a great time with. After you beat those games the first, second, third, fourth time, you're kind of like, oh, I'm sick of that now, which I still want to have those games because it's always fun when you're having friends over or when it's family party night or whatever you're doing to get on there and play it. But here's the better part is you can actually modify this machine to play thousands of games very easily. So anything from Atari all the way up to right now, Sega Dreamcast and every single arcade game ever made. So why not make your Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle machine that much better? And when I wanted to do this, I went online and watched videos, and I actually modified the Marvel Superheroes machine first, which is only two players. And I found that I ran into a lot of dead ends because I was watching videos that were explaining it fairly easy on how to do it, but they were skipping steps. And I'm sure they didn't mean to do that, but a lot of the people that were providing the tutorials had a lot of background in arcade modding and hooking up electronics and emulation station and all that kind of stuff. But I had no experience whatsoever, so I was coming into it as, I just need to know what I need and how to do it. And I ended up having to watch a lot of different videos and put parts and pieces together to figure out what I needed. And I know if you modify one of these, you're probably going to want to buy everything you need all in one shot, get it all together, and bang it out and get it ready to play. So the point of this video is going to be, I'm going to show you exactly what you need, I'm going to provide links in the description, and I'm going to show you exactly what you need to do to get this thing up and running as a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle 4-player arcade cabinet that will play thousands of games. So let's get right to it. Here's exactly what you're going to need.
Let's get show!
Okay guys, so here's what you need. You can order all of this stuff from Amazon except for a couple things you can go and buy locally or order from the website. But basically you need this 4-player arcade kit. Now, I have the link in the description, but you can see it's got all the buttons, all the hookups, the joysticks, the knobs, the things that screw the buttons on here, the washers. The link will be in the description for that. You are also going to need some painter's tape. You are also going to need some multi-purpose ties. I got those from the dollar store. You will also need an HDMI cable, which I got from the dollar store as well. You will also need a Raspberry Pi 3B. Now, this is where I got a little confused on some of the tutorials that I watched. This is a kit that I ordered on Amazon. I think it was $80. Now, this is the actual Raspberry Pi here. And this is the power supply. Now, the first video I watched did not tell me that I needed a power supply, so I was left with having to come up with that later on, and it stalled me out a bit. This is the case for the Raspberry Pi, which I highly recommend since it is just a fragile circuit board in there, and you don't want that to be exposed in the back of your machine. So this case, which I'll show you in a little bit what it looks like put together, is wonderful. You're also going to need the video converter, which I'll have in the description. This is going to allow you to hook the Raspberry Pi up to your Ninja Turtles LCD monitor. And then this is the control that hooks up to it, which this will do your color, contrast, saturation, clarity, all that stuff. Then you're also going to need a micro SD card, $18 on Amazon. You are also going to need a step bit. Now this will go into your drill. You will need a drill. I got this at Harbor Freight, the drill, for I think it was $20-$30. This thing here is about $15 at Harbor Freight, and you'll see it goes up to 1 3/8. I don't know if you can see that, but 1 3/8 is the one you need. This is to drill the holes for the extra buttons. This bad boy right here is a hole dozer. Now what this does, this is a really sharp bit that you're gonna put in your drill, and this is what's gonna cut through the plexiglass cover that goes on your control deck. So that's pretty important. This is available, the hole dozer is available at Lowe's or Home Depot. I think it was $15. This is available at Harbor Freight. You just need some sort of a drill. I also am going to be using some industrial Velcro, which I got from Walmart, very, very cheap. And then you're also going to need this 12-volt amplifier to power your audio. And that's important because the audio on the Arcade 1-Up machine is very, very weak, and it does not hook up to the Raspberry Pi. So you're going to want to hook up, you know, I'll show you a pretty economical way to do that. And then this is a power supply that you actually need for the amplifier. I'm going to put the link in the description for that so you know to order these two together. The power, the amplifier. Now these right here are some 4-inch speakers that I got. And the reason I got these is that above the marquee or behind the marquee on the Ninja Turtles machine, which is where the graphics are on the top, there are 2 4-inch or I think 3-inch speakers in there. And the quality is not great. I'm going to tell you right now that on my Marvel machine, it actually blew the speakers. It sounded great for about a week or two. And as you guys know how that works, we cranked it up one night or a couple nights in a row and one of the speakers blew. And guys, both these speakers right here on Amazon, I think they were $12 and they're really nice ones. So they're not going to blow when we hook it up to the amplifier. This right here is a surprise. This is a Leonardo Katana light up deco light. I'm going to show you what that's for. It might be excessive, but in my opinion, it actually adds a lot to the machine. So that's optional, but I'm going to show you what I use it for. And guys, those are $40 or $50 at Walmart, and I got it on Amazon for $7.88. So if you like what I use that for at the end of the video, you can order one and put it in the same spot. I guarantee you you'll like it. It's awesome. But anyway, so that's what you're going to need. I'm going to have the link in the description for everything here so you know exactly what you need. And guys, I'm not skipping any steps. This is what I was talking about. On some of the videos I watched, guys were leaving out 2 or 3 of these things, and you'd get to that part in the build and be like, what do I do here? So then you had to research again, and it took more time. So I wanted to make sure you knew everything you need for this. So the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna install these coin-op buttons. Now, you have to have coin-op buttons on the machine because the stock Ninja Turtle machine does not have that. But when you play arcade games, you can't just have a start button. You actually have to have coin buttons on the front of the machine so that you have a hotkey to go in and out of the games and also to add coins so that you can put credits in on the arcade machines only. So, let's get started. Okay guys, so you're going to want to remove these 4 screws right here with a Phillips screwdriver. That's the first step. And then that will allow you to remove this whole cabinet off the arcade deck, which you can see I'm doing right here. I'm going to set the phone down so I can pull that one white plug off so I can remove it, and then we'll get back to it. But that's the first step. So then you're going to have this one white cord right here, which I have removed. And you see I actually just pulled the control deck right off the machine. And then we come over here to the machine, or to the control deck. You can see this is just gonna be another easy screw right here, screw right here, screw right here, screw right here. And then there's actually 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 deep ones that you're gonna wanna remove. So you're gonna remove all of these and you're gonna move these and then we'll get back to it. All right guys, now be careful not to lose your screws. I loosened them all and then I turned this thing upside down and let them go on the ground and then I just picked them up because they are pretty deep in there. But once they're all out, this thing will just pull right off, exposing the bottom of the control deck. Okay guys, so this can seem a little overwhelming when you look under here, but don't worry. I promise it'll be a little bit more simplified as we go along, but this is all gonna go because obviously we're gonna have to drill into this board and we're gonna have to drill our cover piece, so everything's gotta go. So you can see these joysticks have 4 screws that you unscrew here and here, pull all those out, and then those will come off, and then these buttons, you're just gonna pull these off. I mean, they're not soldered on, so you're just gonna pull off the back of each button. We're gonna do that to all the buttons, and then I'm gonna unscrew all 4 joysticks in those 4 points that I showed you. And then I'm gonna pull all of this off. And then this is your reader board for the joysticks and the buttons. We're also gonna unscrew this in all 4 spots here. We're gonna pull those out and then we're just gonna pull that off. So I'm gonna pull all this off and then I'll show you guys how to get the buttons out. They're pretty easy. These actually just have little tabs. I can't do it while I'm holding the phone, but you just squeeze these tabs in and then they just pop out the front. So I'm going to do that, and then I'll show you the gutted board. And don't worry if you break anything, you guys, if you break any wires, if, you know, one of the buttons gets dinged up, whatever. It doesn't matter because we're going to be using a different set anyway that I showed you. So no worries. Okay, so you can see I've got all the screws out of all of these joysticks. But one thing I wanted to show you is that they do glue these down. So you might have to take a flathead screwdriver and just kind of pry these off of here, because they glue them down to the board, but they're easy to pry off. I can't do it while I'm holding the phone, but I'm gonna set the phone down and pry this one off and just show. So you can see after you have kind of got this under here, these will just pry up and just pull right off. So I'm gonna go ahead and pry the rest of these joysticks off and pull the buttons off, and then show you guys the blank board. All right, guys, so there's our blank board. You can see all the joysticks and all the buttons have been removed, and we're left with just a blank control deck for the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle machine. And then this stuff here I just like to hang on to because you never know if you'll use it for spare parts or if you need it for another project. So I'm just gonna put that stuff away. Let's get to the next. Okay, guys, so it's time to drill our holes on the control deck. So that's where you're going to be using the 1 3/8 step bit. Now, importantly, you're not going to drill all the way to the bottom into the fattest hole on this. You're going to go to the second one up. So I don't know if I can set this down. You're going to go to the second one up right here. Otherwise, the hole's going to be too big and you're going to have major problems. Now, for those of you that haven't drilled before, this is actually very easy. You just put it in the drill and you just ease it in a little bit until you get down. And just to show you how big the hole should be, you can see when I set that bit in there, it goes to the second one. So if you go bigger than that, the buttons are gonna be too small for the hole. Now, here's what you need to do. When you order your 4-player arcade kit, it comes with these screw rings, which if you look at the rings, they're actually the exact same size as the button. So what I did was I put these down where I wanted the extra buttons to go, and I actually used a Sharpie to mark my drill hole. So you can do that on all of them. Now on these decks, the most important thing you need to know is you are going to need extra buttons for player one and player two. Okay, so the middle ones, Michelangelo and Donatello, that's going to be the middle of the board where player one and player two fight. Like if you're playing a fighting game and you need, you know, all the extra buttons, that's why you've got six there. I'm actually going to add two more buttons to these for PlayStation, so I have L1 and R1. But on the edge buttons, Leonardo and Raphael, you're only going to need four buttons, because if you play the 4-player games like Turtles or Simpsons or X-Men, you don't need those extra buttons. And there's really not enough room on the board to put them. So I just did two below on Leonardo, one there, one there. And then on Raphael, the same thing. You just want to diagonally place those, and you want to leave enough space so that you can drill your hole in the plexiglass. So, you know, if we look at a hole here, don't put it right next to the hole. You know, leave yourself a decent amount of space. You can see what I did here. There's a decent amount of space there so that when I drill my plexiglass, the idea is the hole's going to be bigger than the button. So you want to leave enough space so that it doesn't overlap. So we're gonna go right to the drilling and we'll take it from there.
Okay, guys, so get yourself a nice sturdy spot to start your drilling and put your drill bit right on the center hole that you pre-marked. And the key is here is there's no rush, just let the drill do the work. You wanna drill down quite a ways on the front and then flip it over and even it out on the back. And I always keep one of the buttons handy so I can just slip it in the hole and make sure it's not gonna fall through. It's better to be short than too big.
So here is our board with the holes drilled, and I gotta tell you, my hand is a little sore. What I can say to you to help you out is let the drill do the work. It's going to start off a little bit slow as you drill each hole. And then once it gets a little bit further into the wood, it's going to grab a hold. And then the last part is kind of like butter. But what I recommend doing is keep a button with you out there. And then as you're drilling, you can just kind of drop the button into the hole and just make sure it's going to fit before you do the next hole. So just don't overshoot the hole. So if you're not sure, make it smaller and try the button. And if it doesn't fit, then just make it a little bigger, because on my last Marvel machine, I made the mistake of making the hole too big. So there's a gap. So I had to put the button in and put a washer underneath, and it was really, really unprofessional, but I got it to work by jimmy rigging it. So just take your time and drill the holes. Now here's one catch is that player one and player two, as you can see, are gonna have six buttons each, which is good for, you know, A, B, X, Y, L1, R1. But if you're playing PlayStation, one, which I am going to be, you're going to need an L2 and an R2. So I'm actually going to add two more buttons right here, because that's the only space left I have for player one, is right there and right there. And then on player two, which is Donatello, I'm going to have to add one right here. And then you see we've got this space over here between there and Raph. So I'm going to put one here and then one like right here. And I know that's funky, guys, but if you think about it, when you're playing an arcade game, it doesn't really matter where the button is, because your memory and your hands gets used to the buttons. But if you don't have L1, R1, R1, R2, when you play PlayStation, as you know, you're stuck in a lot of games, or you're not able to do some of the moves. So I'm going to go ahead and drill those last two holes, and then we'll go from there. Okay, guys. So you can see I've got my holes all drilled. And what I did was I set this plexiglass piece down on top, and it lines right up with your volume and on off, which you're not going to be using anyway, but it just lines up the rest of the holes. And you can see, you know, the ones that were already on the machine have holes in the plexiglass, but the ones that don't, what you're going to have to do is you're going to have to go to where the covered holes, and you're going to have to make a Sharpie mark right in the center on each of those as your guide. It has to be in the center, so take your time, because when you use this plexiglass cutter, you see how it has the drill to start it off? So that's where you're going to put your drill, is right on the spot that you mark, and then you're going to cut through the plexiglass, because you see the holes on the plexiglass are slightly bigger than the wooden holes. So just take your time and mark your spot right in the middle, and then we're going to go outside and we're going to drill some plexiglass, okay? Now, don't be afraid of this. You might be afraid you're going to cut the, you know, crack the plexiglass or whatever, but I thought the same thing. And when you actually use this thing and you take your time and you don't rush it and you just let the drill do the work, it'll cut through it like butter. So let's go drill. And make sure you have it on, you know, drill in, not pull out. And then we're going to start our first one here right on the first spot. And I'm just going to do it nice and slow to give it a chance to catch. Once it catches the plexiglass, it'll just cut right in like butter, and then it kind of pulls it up, and then you're just going to cut nice and slow, nice and slow. You'll see the shaving might grab a little bit like that, so just hold the glass firm, and then when you pick it up, let's see, we didn't get all the way through, so we're going to go a little bit low. You just don't want to crack it, so you want to go nice and slow. And there's our piece. So you can see, nice clean cut. Got our hole right there. So we're gonna do the rest of the holes, but there you have it. And I'll bring it a little closer here so you can see. You can see there's a lot of shavings, but we have a hole. And this little bit of buildup right here can just be chipped off with the screwdriver. It's already separated, it just didn't come off with the cut. But there you go. All right, guys, so everybody remembers our bottom of our control deck that we pulled off underneath where the joysticks are. So what you're gonna need to do is, you remember that drill bit that I showed you that you're going to be buying at Lowe's? It's the extra sharp one like this. The dozer. This, you see I've got some cuttings on there right now because I just made some cuts I wanna show you guys are very important. Because what happens is the wires that are coming down from your buttons and your joysticks are gonna have to connect underneath to the Pi. So what you're gonna have to do is you're gonna have to, you can see I'm holding it from the front here. You're gonna have to drill one hole in the back right there, one hole on the other side, one hole through that gate wall right there to allow access to this side over here, another one on the other side, and four on the bottom. And those four are actually for your coin buttons. Now, I didn't mean to skip ahead on you guys, but this piece underneath the control panel just slides out. And when you take your step bit from Harbor Freight and drill these holes, you'll have to measure them out. I think this is an 18 inch piece. So they need to be about 3 3/8 3 3/5 space apart, inches apart. But I chose to do the colors to match my buttons on the top.
you might want to use the white buttons, but you're going to drill and then put those through and then screw them on with the washer rivets on the other side. And then this slides back down in there. And then when you put your control panel, that's why you've got those four holes. So that when you put it on top, you have access down through the holes to these buttons here. So you can see once you put it on, they're very close, but this piece will actually block that. So make sure you take your time when you doze through that. Now, another thing I need to show you is once you put this on and you've drilled these side holes right here, you're going to have to take your step bit, you're going to mark those with a marker, and then you're going to have to drill through those with that step bit, the same one you drilled your buttons with on the control deck. You can see it's a little bit sloppy because of the graphics on there, but it doesn't matter because once you put the cover on, it's going to completely block that. And sorry, this is hard to do one-handed, but I'm going to put this cover on in that spot, and then you see now those holes that I drilled, I've got access through here over to this control deck. So a lot of people struggle with that step just because they don't know how to get the wires through this part, and if you don't have this part on there, it makes the deck look really ugly. But just take your time, use the dozer to make your cuts. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And then your only two cuts that you're going through the wood are these two on the outside. Now you've got access to everything inside the control deck. So that's an easy step. We're done with that. Okay, so here's my control deck. Now this looks like a huge mess. But basically, you know, you've got player 4, player 3, player 2, player 1. Now each player is going to have an encoder, and you see the encoder is the same as that chart that I showed you. The red ones are your power for your LEDs. There's actually one red one right on the end here, and that's where I put my LED. And then that breaks off, and the black one goes to each of Raphael's LED side positive and negatives. Not the ones that are on the button, but I'm going to put a red on the positive here, a red on the positive here, a red on the positive here, red, red, and so on. You see this button over here on player 1 and player 4 is going to be on this side of that divider that's on the plastic board that goes underneath. That's why you're drilling that hole in the side, so you have access to this one for player 4. And for player 1, you have to drill that hole in the wall. But then you're basically going to connect all your LEDs and then plug them into the power. And then you see I started off with K1 here, and that's my A button. K2 is my B button. K3 is my X button, K4 is my Y button, K5 is my start button, and then this one's blank when I come down to K12 down here, but if I go to my buttons that have multiple buttons for PlayStation, then I just did the same thing where I started from the other side. So you've got your X, B, Y, A over here, and then on this side I've got L1, R1, L2, R2, and the same thing for player 3, because these two center ones are my fighting buttons, so they have more buttons. So as long as you make sure, guys, on every single player that each button is in the same spot on the encoder, everything's going to work fine when you turn on your emulation station and you configure your controls. If you have one button off and it's in a different plug in your encoder, it's going to screw the whole thing up. So same thing with the joysticks. The joysticks are actually really simple. You're just going to screw those down, and actually the ones that come with this kit actually line up with the Ninja Turtles cabinet holes. So I put one here, a screw here, and a screw here, and then I actually just put, like, in the corner I put a couple of extra anchor screws just to hold it in, because if you've got some rough players and they shake the arcade sticks a lot, I figured two screws wasn't enough, so I put one on each corner just to give it extra reinforcement. And then the joysticks just have a big long white, it's like a multi-pin plug, and then right on the end of your encoder here, there's a multi-pin plug for the joystick on each one. So it's just one-to-one on the joystick, white plug to white plug on the encoder, same thing for all four. And you can see that on the chart, the big long one here on the end is your joystick. So that's basically all you need to know about the wiring. It seems overwhelming if you haven't done it, guys. I was overwhelmed, but once you get into it, and you just start plugging stuff in, you can see it's very easy. You know, just make sure the same button goes to the same spot on the encoder on each board. And then what I did was, to kind of clean things up, I just put those zip ties that I showed you from the dollar store. I just zip tied everything down nice and neat so that there weren't wires, you know, rainbowing up and bubbling up all over to make it difficult to put back on. So I just tightened everything down. And then one thing that's really helpful, guys, is if you take your USB. Now, if you don't know what these are, every single one of your players is going to have a USB. And it's basically got this type of end on one end, and then it's got this end on the other. That's your USB. So that's how you plug it into the encoder. So your fat end goes on the encoder here, and then you're gonna run that wire inside the machine, and the USB plugs into the Pi. But what's really nice is if you plug this end, this fat end here, I'm sorry, I've got the wrong end. If you plug your fat end here into the encoder, you can actually plug the USB into a phone charger and it will light the buttons up. So what I did was, while I was testing my LEDs, I just had an extension cord laying by me with a phone charger or a box with that USB powered up so that I could plug it into each encoder. And when you plug it in, it should light up. Now, here's the thing. If it's not lighting up, you probably have your positives and your negatives backwards. And even though I was really anal and really careful with all however many umpteen of these buttons to make sure I had it on the right ones, I still missed some. So when I tested it with my USB to check the lights, sure enough, there was 2, 3, 4 different buttons spread out on the board that were reversed. So I just fixed those, reversed the red and the black, and they lit up just fine. So there you go, guys. That's really the hardest part of this whole thing, and it can seem overwhelming and really, but it's not. It's just like, you know, you're plugging things in. If you know how to do basic, you know, plug the same into this same thing into the same plug on everyone, you're good to go. So now what we're going to do is we're going to put this control deck on top of that piece that we drilled up here with the holes, and we're going to run our wires down, and then we're going to expose those in the back of the machine, and we should be good to go. So let's move. Okay, guys, so what we've got going on here is we have laid our control deck back down after installing the buttons and the joysticks. And now we're just tightening down those 4 screws that we used to take off the deck. So I'm on my last one here. I'm gonna tighten that down. And then in the back, you'll notice out of those holes we drilled to make space for the USBs, I've got the USB cords coming out, all 4 of them ready to plug into the Raspberry Pi. And I just labeled them, you know, 2, so I would know which is which, 3, because a couple of them are coming out of the same holes, so you don't want to play the guessing game. It'll just save you a little bit of time. But everything is nice and snug. It might take you a little bit to get this deck back on smoothly. It doesn't want to slide in smooth at first, so you kind of have to look underneath where the holes are to get these screws back in. But that's the hardest part of the whole project, is wiring up the buttons and the joysticks and getting it all installed into the deck. So let's move on to some of the more easier stuff. Here we go. All right, guys, so now is the easy part. We're done with the control deck. Really, all the drilling and the cutting and all that is done now. So what we're going to do is remove the back of our Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles LCD screen and get into the CPU. So you see there's a screw on each side here holding that on, so I'm going to pull those off. We'll be right back. All right, so we're going to remove that, and then you see what we've got in here. There's not a whole lot of space to work with, but basically what you're going to see is you've got these 2 plugs right here. You got the yellow, red, black, and then you've got your board plug here from your LCD. And then you've got this ground screw right here. So you're going to remove this ground screw, and you're going to remove both these plugs. I'll go ahead and do that, and we'll be right back. All right, so there we are, removed. And then most importantly, keep your ground screw right here, because you are going to have to ground the new board when we put it on. So next step, here we go. All right, guys, so we're going to grab our new LCD controller that we got from Amazon. And I'm going to open this guy up here and show you basically what we're looking at.
So this thing's pretty cool. This has the ability to have your LCD screen from your Turtle machine read the Raspberry Pi. So the first things first, you see this hole right here where my thumb is? That's going to be where you put that ground screw. So we're going to attach that first. Once that's attached, we're going to connect the other two and I'll show you where those go. Alright guys, so this is pretty self-explanatory. Your LCD controller, this guy here, the long one, is going to go right here, right next to your ground, and then your red, black, and yellow cord, that's going to go right over here in this white spot right here, so these two white plugs. So we're going to plug those in and mount this guy, and then I'll be right. Alright, so we are mounted on there and we're looking good. And we're grounded, so it's okay to mount that on the back of the screen right there. And then we're left with this control board. Now this is like your, if you look at it up close, this is like your, let me see if it'll sharpen there, your menu, your contrast, your screen adjustment. I don't use this personally on the mods that I have, but if you do want to adjust the color and the sharpness and the contrast and all that, it's gonna go, you know, easy enough. The red one, red end goes right into the board. And then this white guy right here, he's gonna go right into here. So I'm gonna go ahead and mount that and then I'm gonna be right. Okay guys, so your Arcade 1 power up that you got with the machine when you bought it, that powers up your Arcade 1 up. The tip of that is your power source for this. So you're actually gonna plug this right into here and that's your power and boom, we're plugged in. And then I always pick up the power strip just because I'm gonna put this inside the cabinet. That way we can plug this and our Raspberry Pi and anything else that we want to plug in inside the cabinet all in one spot. Okay guys, so here's your Raspberry Pi. Now this is probably the easiest part of the whole thing. You're just going to take your four USBs that you had coming through the backside and plug those into the four USB spots. That's going to control all four of your controls on the top of the deck. Now, these are player 1, player 2, player 3, player 4, so you do have to do a little bit of trial and error once the game is up and running. You might have to switch player 1 or player 2 or whichever ones to get it in the right spot. And then you're going to take your HDMI that I showed you and the things you're going to need and plug it into the Raspberry Pi. And then your power source goes right here. Now you see everything is hooked into the power strip. And then what you're going to do is you're going to put your HDMI right into here. And then that's going to connect the Raspberry Pi video into your mounted VGA board. So now we've got our Raspberry Pi. And I left the cover off this, you guys, just to show you so you could see it a little better. You are going to want to put the cover on this before you plug everything in. And then just to give you another quick example, your SD card is going to go right here. We're going to go over how to put the games on the SD card, but that's where that goes. So everything is all running off this, and then I'm going to put the cover on and just kind of mount this nicely up against the side. So let's... All right, guys. So now it's time to move on to the audio a little bit. Now, these speakers that come with the Arcade 1-Up, I already have them, the screws removed, but you see it's basically four screws on each speaker, and then those are just going to lift off. Boom. Boom. And then you're left with these grills right there. Now you remember I showed you these nicer speakers that we picked up. So basically all you're going to do is we're going to install these nicer speakers, you know, right over the grate. So we're going to put the sound right over the grate. That way we have the louder sound coming through the speaker from the amplifier. So I'm going to go ahead and screw those down, and you may want to solder the speaker wire on. If you don't like to solder, you could twist them on there, but you guys that know audio stuff know it's a lot better to solder those on there so you get a solid connection. So I'm going to go ahead and connect those and then we'll be right back. All right guys, so my speakers are installed. I basically just drilled a little pre-hole pilot and then screwed those suckers in. And then I put a little bit of Gorilla tape on here underneath the panel just to hold the wiring. Now these wires coming down are what are going to lead into our amplifier. So let's get to that part. Okay guys, so curveball here. My speakers were a little bit too big to get that panel back in, so what I did was I Dremeled out a little bit of space in the back. Not really a big deal to me because this is going to be facing the wall, and actually I kind of liked it because now I feel like some of the sound is going to come through the back as well from those high ends. So again, you might want to order smaller speakers. I wanted to get a little bit louder of speakers, so I went ahead and went with these ones. As you can see, it's ever so close. It's like, you know, maybe 3/4 of an inch too wide, so not a big deal. I just used my step bit and I dremeled out a little bit of space there so I could get that panel in and attach it back. But here is our amplifier, which you saw in the link and in the beginning. Comes with a nice little case. You got your volume, your highs, your lows, your bass, everything on here. And I went ahead and Velcroed that right here just because a lot of people mount these inside the machine. But what's the point in doing that where every time you have to use the volume, you have to reach inside the machine to turn it up and down? I just like to reach up on the top and just turn it up and down right here when I'm playing the game. So you can see as you're playing, you know, on the front, really not gonna see that. And then you reach over the top and boom, your volume control is right there. So, and then again, those speakers, not really gonna notice it. I actually was upset about it at first, thought about returning the speakers, but then said, hey, you know what? If I open up this panel a little bit right here, it's actually gonna let a lot of the sound come out right there on the highs. So I actually liked it. So I'm gonna leave it. And actually, if I wanted to get a little bit fancy with it, I do have these covers that I didn't use, which can actually be mounted right there over the top to cover the space, which is probably what I'm gonna do because you can see that looks a lot neater, a lot nicer. So I'll go ahead and mount that when I'm done, but I just wanted to let you guys in on the next step. So now what we're gonna do is I've got my speaker wire coming from my highs coming through the low here, or coming through the bottom of the cabinet. So I'm gonna run my speaker wire from these up and I'm gonna actually hook them in. You can see where the speakers connect in right here. We're gonna go from there, so I'll get that hooked up and we'll be right back. Okay guys, so I've got my highs hooked up and then this is where I went a little over the top, okay? And this is just something that I like to do. I got a 12-inch subwoofer and I went ahead and put that in the bottom of the cabinet right here just because, you know, why not? You don't have to play it loud all the time, but if you do want it loud, this is how you do it. So we've got a 12 volt amp with our two highs up here, which are gonna have the grills over the top. Then we've got our 12 inch subwoofer that we control from our amplifier right here. Now this thing is super loud. So when you knock the foot clan into the wall, you're gonna hear it thud. Now the nice thing about this amp is you can turn the bass way down and just play it without the bass, or you can turn it up and play it with the bass. But I mean, if you're gonna do it, you gotta do it right, you know? And I got this 12-inch subwoofer, I think it was 40 bucks off of Facebook Marketplace. You can get them brand new on Amazon for 79 bucks, but everyone knows these are easy to come by. You can get the home stereo ones, you can get the ones that don't plug in, I mean, and they run off the amp, so that's what's nice. And it just gives it the extra oomph. So if I wanna play this thing as a jukebox, which I always do, I'll put music into one of the folders and use it as a jukebox. I can do that. But the music part is done. So once again, this part was kind of ugly on the top up here, you guys. But if you remember right, I'm gonna go ahead and put these covers over the back and that's gonna secure nicely and be beautiful. And then we've got a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle arcade machine that will thump when you play it. Or if you don't wanna thump, that's fine too. So the last thing here is, well, I'm gonna move into the next step here. We're just about finished.
Let's kick show!
All right guys, so this part is going to be showing you how to put the games onto your Arcade 1-Up Ninja Turtle machine. So first thing you're gonna wanna do is go to Google and go to Arcade Punks. Now, when you go to Arcade Punks, we can go home here. I think I went one screen ahead, but you go to home and then you're gonna go to where it says Game Packs Downloads and you're gonna go to ROM sets and packs. Now, it's very simple. There's gonna be hundreds of different ROM packs you can get on here. Most of them are gonna have a lot of games or all the games, but some of them have a little bit different menu, different layout. But go ahead and pick the one that you want and then download the torrent. And then you guys know you have to have BitTorrent to download torrents. So go ahead and download BitTorrent and then you'll get the torrent off of the program and you'll have that on your desktop or your downloads or wherever you put the torrent. It will have to be unzipped most of the time, so go ahead and unzip it. Then you're gonna go to program called SD card formatter. It's a free program. You're gonna put your SD card into the computer. If it's a brand new card that you just ordered, you're gonna quick format it. If it's one you've already been using and it's got stuff on it, you're gonna override the format. That's gonna take a few, might take a few hours depending on the size of your memory card. Go ahead and let that format, and once it's done, your card is ready to use. Now you're gonna get this program, and this is a step that a lot of the people skipped when I was watching how to do this. You're gonna get, it's called Balena Etcher, or Balena Etcher, I don't know which one, how it's pronounced, but when you open up that program, it's gonna let you select the image. So you're gonna go to the image that you got from Arcade Punks, and it's gonna highlight that there. So when you go here, it's gonna let you go to your downloads or your desktop, and then you can pick your image that you want. Mine's already off of here, so I'm not gonna go in there and mess with that, but basically, that'll be highlighted here. Then you're gonna go to your target. That's gonna let you select your memory card. So if it's slot C, D, E, F, wherever you have that plugged into your computer from the card reader, you select the card that you wanna put the image on, and then you flash it. Guys, it might take several hours. It can be frustrating if you're not patient, but that's the longest part of this process, is you're putting a lot of information on the card, so you gotta be patient and just let it transfer. Now, if you try to drag that image on the card just by itself, it's not gonna work. You have to use Balena Etcher, otherwise it will not transfer the image correctly and the Raspberry Pi will not read the image. So let's transfer the image onto the card, and then we'll go over to the arcade machine and I'll show you what it looks like when you boot it up. Here we go.
All right, so everything is powered up and you can see we've got the little cursor blinking in the screen, and then boom, here goes our Raspberry Pi with our image, and it's loading up nicely. So that's gonna load everything up. And then you see, guys, this is kind of one of the cool things I wanted to show you, is this Leonardo Katana. You can see I do have the speakers mounted on there, as I told you. Those are screwed on nicely, but your amplifier is back here. Now, right now, I think it's on Bluetooth mode because I had it hooked up to my phone, but I can switch it to input, and then now it's playing my game music, and then it should boot up your games. It takes about 10 seconds, and then boom, now we're in, and we've got everything ready to go. All of our menus, all of our arcade, all of our whatever ROMs we added on there. Now it's not just a Ninja Turtle machine, it's got everything. And this was my little secret, guys, is I put this Leonardo Katana, I mounted it, there's a little screw kit, and I like it to block the amplifier. So when you're looking at this thing from the front, you can see that it's got the Ninja Turtle Katana, and it's even got a little button on the front to turn on a light. So when you watch this thing, you know, or you're playing it at nighttime, it's so cool looking. Another nice little touch you guys can see is, like, I did install LED strips from Walmart on the back of the machine. That just makes it glow behind the machine. Just another touch you can do. Those are like $5 for like 6 feet of LED with the remote. But you can see this is our finished modded Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles machine. So it's got everything on there. It's got the speakers, the amplifier. I mounted that Katana just to block the amplifier. And then I can reach back and turn it up or down without going behind the cabinet. But guys, I gotta show you this. I'm gonna go to my favorites list just because this particular image that I got is pretty awesome. But let's go to favorites, and I'm gonna go in here. And then I wanna give you a little hint of how different this is. Some of you guys played this machine and heard the kind of the ghetto Ninja Turtles song that they had on there. It wasn't Arcade 1UP's fault. They actually got the music from the company, and when they sent it to them, it was not the correct song. But just to demo out this sound system for you guys, I'm gonna go to, there we are, we're at Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. I'm gonna load it up. We're gonna go into the game, and then it'll go to your arcade screen. It's gonna start loading. Look how beautiful those buttons are, guys. They just look awesome. Our coin up buttons are down there. It's going to load the ROM up right now, and then I'm going to crank this up a little bit just to give you a little hint of how loud this sucker is, okay? So I'll start the song. And then you guys see the coin buttons that we installed down here. I'm just going to go ahead and hit a coin button, and then we've got all four turtles ready to rock and roll on a four-player modded Ninja Turtle machine with our added speakers and Leonardo Katana. And guys, this thing is awesome. It's ready to play. So I hope you enjoyed this video. One other thing I wanted to mention is you can put the back on the cabinet if you want to. I don't particularly do that just because
It's in the corner and you're not going to see the back. And that way, if I need to get back there and adjust something, I don't have to mess with it. Here's the Marvel machine that I modded, you guys. And you see, I always do the same thing. I got the cap shield for that one just to block the amplifier that's back there as well. But now I've got a two-player one right here ready, and I've got a four-player one. And man, guys, this was a cool project, but it was definitely worth it. So if you have this Ninja Turtle cabinet and you want to mod it up and play some games, I recommend you do so because you will not regret it. It is absolutely awesome. But anyways, so here it is. I'll play the outro to take you out. And guys, if you have any questions about any of this, please feel free to comment below. If you have any additional comments you want to tell me about or anything that I missed, please let me know. This is the first tutorial video that I've made, but it was a lot of fun, guys, and I highly recommend it. So good luck. Take your time. Have fun. It's a great, fun project, and the final product when you're done is phenomenal. So happy modding, and oh, what's that? It sounds like somebody's at the door. Who the heck would be coming to my door right now? I'm not sure. Let's go.
Like, yo, what's up, man? It's me, Michelangelo. Hey, I heard that you modded the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles arcade machine. So, I heard it's also four player. What do you say? I'll trade you some pizza. You let me and my brothers come in and play. Cowabunga, dude!
Now Iris reporter was hot on the trail, determined to put these crooks in jail. She spied the bad guys and saw it.